Dear Dad, how's everything over there? I know I haven't spoken for a while now. It's been a couple of years that I haven't written a letter to you, but I think it's time to catch up on things. What does death mean? That is what I asked myself when my mom told me my dad had died. My name is Rayron Gracie, and I was born into one of the most famous martial arts family. The Gracie family. I was born into Jiu-Jitsu as naturally I was born into my family, but Jiu-Jitsu was not born among my family. It began in Fudo, Japan as an art of the battlefield, of life and death, but changing to the art of control that leads not to death, but to peaceful submission. Its essential nature is to allow the smaller, weaker person to prevail against the stronger and more aggressive. As such, it preaches technique and strategy over size and strength. My family inherited this ancient art of the samurai when they traveled across oceans. They took it, changed it, and fought with it. In time, they created a unique interpretation of Jiu-Jitsu, very different from those feudal origins. Most importantly, they had the courage to prove its values, not with words written in ink, but with deeds written in blood. At an early age, I watched my father and relatives fight from the sidelines. As a kid, watching them train as they towered over me, I viewed them as gods, as if Apollo and Ares were battling in front of my eyes. But although I was a spectator of so much greatness as a kid, I would soon find out what it meant to be part of the family. Growing up in the family, there was always a constant pressure to be somebody and live up to the family name. Not just from my relatives, but from the rest of the world. Being the only son of my father, all eyes were on me from the moment I was born. I always felt forced to train, because of the pressure to fulfill these expectations from everyone around me, I never really enjoyed jiu-jitsu. It wasn't until 5 years ago, when I moved to New York City, that I started to see the beauty in it. My plan was to move to the city to learn English for 6 months, but it quickly changed. I began to open the gym, and because I constantly put myself in the environment, a real passion was sparked. And although I could find a lot of the answers to my questions on the mats, there were still some only my father could answer. I'm looking for an answer. In order to find it, you need the eyes of a special being, untouched by beliefs or complex fears, whose emotions are clear than crystal and changed like the weather. This epiphany does not arise from the elderly man in the corner, but from the child running around, whose wisdom is greater than any philosopher. To have the eyes we once had of a child is to remember the secret of life. I was born in São Paulo, Brazil, and when I was 2 months old, moved to Rio. Growing up, I didn't live a normal childhood because I was the son of Ryan Gracie. I was a happy kid. I lived with my mother, but because I felt a stronger connection with my father, the majority of my time was spent with my grandma in Rio. My dad lived alone in an apartment in São Paulo, a 1 hour flight from Rio. Every month, my grandma would drop me off at the airport, and I would board a flight alone to visit him. He used to take me to his gym to watch him train and teach lessons. And at home, in his living room, he would play together. I would spend the entire day with him. I used to sit on his shoulders and witness how much he was respected and admired. My father was my hero, and the time we spent together are my most valuable memories. I looked up to him, and everything was perfect. Thank you. My father was a fighter who had a very controversial life. There are many stories about the life my dad lived. Some say he was a villain, a violent person who did no good.
Bicho, aonde, rapaz? Eu só preciso mais de 40 dias pra treinar pra poder te bater mais. Que 40 dias eu já te dou porrada. Porque você é burro, você não sabe fazer uma posição, rapaz. Eu vou quebrar a tua cara.
But there's a kid who knows different. A kid who loved him with all his heart. Who always looked up to him, no matter what story he heard. On December 8, 2007, we celebrated my 6th birthday together. And 1 week later,
centenas de pessoas se despediram hoje do lutador Ryan Gracie. A família dele está inconformada. Diz que o médico que o atendeu numa delegacia de São Paulo errou. O pai promete levar o caso para a justiça.
O corpo de Ryan Gracie foi enterrado às 4 horas da tarde no cemitério São João Batista, no Rio, com uma salva de palmas. O clã do Jiu-Jitsu, acostumado a tantas vitórias, sentiu a dor da perda.
Ele era um guerreiro da família, é um soldado da gente.
What does death mean? That was what I asked myself when my mom told me my dad had died. I was traveling with her in a city near Rio at the time. And I remember her telling me that he got really sick, and I replied right away, "Mom, you know, he'll be fine. He's so strong. Don't even worry about it." Because in my mind, he was invincible. On our way back, we stopped at a gas station, and as soon as I came in, I looked at the TV and I saw my dad. It was the news coverage. But I thought it was a video call. And I remember looking at the TV and said, "Dad, hey, I'm here. And look at my dad, Mom." And she rushed in front of me to distract me, and she began to cry. I remember asking her, "Mom, why are you crying?" And she said, "I don't know, just something fell in my eye." We continued the trip back home, and when we got to my grandma's house, she parked in front of it and she told me what had happened, but in a gentle way, as you would to tell a kid something like this. She said that he had passed away and that it was a medical error. I remember not being shocked at all and still being happy from seeing him 1 week before. And I was just thinking about when I was gonna go to São Paulo again. I came into my grandma's house and I saw her crying. I went up to her and I asked, "Grandma, why are you crying? I already know that my dad passed." "Don't cry." And in that moment, she looked at me and she knew I had no idea on what death meant. Days passed and he didn't show up for Christmas. When it was time for me to go visit him, nobody took me to the airport. When Father's Day came around, he didn't show up. And day by day, I began to realize what death meant. And that's when it kicked in.
When I was a kid, I feared the dark. Now it's other things that bother me. I still have so many questions. Questions only my dad could answer. Why are you not here by my side? Why did you leave me at such a young age? Weren't you supposed to be at my wedding? Play with your grandchildren? Weren't you supposed to surprise me on my birthday? Why do I feel so alone? After my dad passed away, I started writing a series of letters to communicate with him, hoping that somehow I would find the answers to my questions.
November 13, 2009. Dear Dad, how are things there in heaven? I got really sad that you left. If you didn't call that doctor, they gave you the remedy to sleep. But I love you. And your mom has been praying a lot. I wish you were here at this moment, playing with me. A lot of cool stuff is happening at my school, and I'll be a fighter just like you. I love you, Dad, and I hope you get this letter. It was your son who wrote it. I was 7 years old when I wrote this letter.
Growing up without a father was something I was not prepared for. These letters were a way of making me feel like he was still here by my side. In my darkest moments, as well as my happiest. Dad, today is the day I'm moving to New York City. I remember seeing all of your photos from there, and I'm really excited to see it in person. Dear Dad, I have been training a lot, and I think I'm starting to like jiu-jitsu. Hey Dad, I finally won my first tournament. I fought this guy, he was heavier than me. I couldn't submit him, but I did the same single leg you used to do. It was great. I can't wait to compete again. I wish you were here so we could celebrate. Hey Dad, something really exciting happened today. I got my blue belt. I thought I was gonna stay in the yellow belt forever. My Uncle Hans and my cousins gave it to me. Am I good enough? I don't know, but I hope you're proud. Dad, today I competed in my first big tournament. I got second place at the Pan Ams. I hope one day I can win just like you did. I was very happy. Everybody was saying I looked like you. Tomorrow will be my first time competing in the world. I'm really nervous. What should I do? Please watch over me. Thank you for watching over me. Still wandering from A to B, 50. I have written these letters for the past 13 years. Some days I have all the right words to write. And others I just sit and reflect. You can learn about life in every situation, in nature, daily problems, or life issues. These experiences are able to shape you, but people don't see it. It's not because if something happens to you that you're going to learn from it. Sometimes you just can't see the big picture. When that stuff happened to me, I was 6 years old. I'm really glad that at a very young age, I was able to learn the lessons that life was trying to teach me. I could have used my father's death as an excuse not to train or do anything and live in his shadow. That was the inner battle I had since I was a kid. And I knew we'd get to a point where I'd have to make a decision one day. But only now I realize I actually have to make this decision not once, but every single day, every morning and every moment, because what shapes your life is now. We do anything not to face and act upon this inner battle. We distract ourselves. When I moved to New York, I didn't have any friends and spent a lot of time by myself. I was forced to reflect on my thoughts, and this was the best thing that could have ever happened to me. I realized that happiness is about struggle. The only moment I'm truly happy is when I'm fighting. The path of struggle is the only way to live. This is what destiny chose for me. I have to embrace it as much as I can. I was born into the Gracie family, and I'm a Gracie fighter. It is my obligation to dedicate my life to keep writing the tale of the Gracie family. Dear Dad, how's everything over there? I know I haven't spoken for a while now. It's been a couple of years that I haven't written a letter to you, but I think it's time to catch up on things.
There's a house built out of stone, wooden floors, walls, and window cells.
I have moved to New York. My Uncle Hans and my cousins have been helping me a lot. I still have those dreams with you every now and then, and I wake up crying every time. Not of sadness, but of happiness, because they always feel so real. People say you're happier as a kid, and I didn't understand why, but now I do. I realize my happiest moments were with you. I also started competing, and I've been doing pretty good. Every time my arm is being lifted or kept down, I look to the crowd to see if I can find your smiling face. I haven't found it yet, but I know you're there. I wish you could have stayed a little longer. You could take me to a tournament or even teach me how to shave. You're not gonna believe it, Dad. I got my purple belt. I have been competing in every tournament, and I hope I am making you proud. I remember having so much fun with you, playing with my hero. Everything was perfect back then. If I could choose, I'd still be playing with you in the living room. Man, what a mom you got. She's the best grandma in the world, and every time I look at her, I see you. Miss you so much, but I can't go see you yet. I still got some stuff to do here. I love you, Dad, from your son, Rayron.
Drinking it in while I'm drifting away, breathing you out of my lungs, up through the cosmos and out into space. You are my oxygen, but you're gone, gone, gone. Anywhere I go, I swear I can feel you. Maybe there is nothing I can do. I've been talking to your ghost. Oh, you're the only one who knows.